Welcome to our live session, the first in the series of Unstereotype with Lakshmi. Hi Roshni, good to see you. Hi Aishwarya, hi Pooja. Hi Pete and Mani, Kalpana, Neha. Ethnic Wordsworth, that's a lovely name. Sanya, Tyler. Lovely people, thank you for joining in. We have a very, very special session today. Hi Ritu. Waving back to you, Kirti. Hi, Tashi. Good to see all you lovely women and, of course, some men here. Thank you for joining in. We have a very, very special guest joining in today. So we are Lakshmi, right? And we do things differently. I mean, where does a community of women come together to talk about money? Yes, money, not fashion, not relationships. Only in our community, the Being Lakshmi community. Because we believe all other conversations are very, very easy if you have the money, right? So let's do this Women's Day by recognizing a man. We're going to wait for a few more people to join in. And of course, our guest of honor, Amish Tripathi, to join in. And we will take it from there. Have you guys sent any questions for Amish? Do you have any questions? Please send it. We'll ask Amish as and when I get a chance. Sorry, Kalpana. Yes, we are enjoying these sessions as much as you are, Kalpana. It's been a really, really fun time for Team Lakshmi also to put together all these interesting sessions. Hi, Varsha. Neil, Arpita Rao. Oh, there's a legend lady as well. Hi, legend lady. Hartika. Fantastic. I think we're loving all of you joining in. Like I said, if you have any questions for Amish, please feel free to ask. And we will ask him. Hi, Shivani. Hi, Shweta. It's so good to see some of my really, really lovely people. Happy Women's Day. Absolutely. Every day is a Women's Day. So today we are going to speak to the author, Amish Tripathi. And we are going to ask him, our topic for today is the role of women in ancient India and how have we translated it to today's world. So it'll be interesting to know, because a lot of what we do and think is based on what we've seen, what we've heard from our elders, and therefore we continue to follow those norms. So it'll be nice to hear from Amish, you know, what he thinks. Shweta, you wanted to ask if we can invest in a blue chip company via SIP? Absolutely. Totally can. And you can invest a very small amount. But today we will not make this an investing platform, investing chat. But we will make it more about why, as a woman, why just women, actually, even men, why do we need to invest our money, and what is the role of money in our life? What is the role of women managing their money? So we're going to just wait for Amish to join in and we will take it from there. I was just telling everybody who've joined in earlier that we are Lakshmi, we do things differently, and we have a community called Being Lakshmi, where women come together and talk about money, obstacles, opportunities, everything around money. So do join in into the community and ask questions. And we have a lot of mentors there, a lot of women financial advisors, our money coaches. All of them will answer all the queries that you may have. Also, like I said, conversations are very, very easy. When you have the money, right? Everything else is just happens far more easier. Relationships, fashion, lifestyle, beauty, all of that, right? Great. Any other questions, guys? Please, girls, please ask. And a happy Women's Day to you, not just today. I truly believe that Women's Day has become a sort of a circus. I think we need to make every day Women's Day. Do you girls agree? If you agree, please go ahead and say yes. I'm loving all the hearts. What is the role of a man in a woman's life? Do we want Amish to answer that? Okay, we will just wait for him to join in. In the meantime, we are running our series, our campaign for the month, which is Unstereotype by Unstereotype with Lakshmi. We've had two very, very interesting panels, and we will continue to do very interesting live sessions, master classes. So please follow us at Lakshmi. You can click, the link is there in our bio, and you can click it and register. Once you register, you will get reminders for all the lives that we are doing, as well as our master classes. We just did a financial fitness boot camp yesterday. And if you're interested in any of that, particularly women who want to ask about investing, please do write to us. Let us know. Whenever we have the next session, we will call you. Okay, Team Lakshmi, we would really like you to reach out to Amish and find out what is happening. We are waiting for him with a bated breath. No other questions other than investing? Happy Women's Day, everyone. Okay, Kirti wants to know how to learn stock market. Since I don't have a knowledge, please throw some light on how to ace it. Like I said, Kirti, we keep doing financial fitness boot camps. Please join in and we'd be happy to take you through this. Okay. Yes, everybody wishing us happy Women's Day. Thank you so much. Let's see if we have. You want some health tips, Shivani, while we wait for Amish ji? That needs another session. Okay, girls, come on. You need to ask me some questions. Have any of you read any Amish Tripathi books? Come on, tell me the names. Okay, Amish has joined in. All right. One second, I'm just calling him. There. Yeah, he's just about to join in. We're just waiting for him to come.
So sorry.
No problem. Thank you so much for joining in. Sorry, I don't know whether I'm taking your request. So.
No. Yeah, there was some confusion. Because I thought it's like a typical, StreamYard or something. So I was trying to find out there. And then I contacted my my assistant in India. Ki abhi kya karna hai? And then she said Instagram Live. I said, which account? So I nit-nit, tech troubles, but it's all sorted now.
Yeah. I know. When I did my first live, I went live a couple of times. And then when I finally went live, nobody turned up. So...
No, it seems like there's a lot of comments coming. So
yes, thank you.
You clearly have a good following.
Thank you, Amish. Thank you so much for joining in. It's great to have you. Everybody, that we are Lakshmi, so we do things differently. we have thought-provoking questions on existing norms, traditions, mindsets, especially those related to women. Okay. And think that this dialogue merits some attention, because I think we have enough data to say that the number one reason that women don't take charge of a lot of their decisions is, one, because they don't manage their money, or because there is a norm that tells that men do a better job than women. So we said, let's have a man and let's get his viewpoint, and not just any, right, but the amazing author Amish.
Oh, thank you.
No introduction. I think he's one who's already, he's got followers who are already tuned into mythology. But Amish, interestingly, you've got the woke also to wake up to our ancient history, culture, because, the millennials, the Gen Z have all started, you know, they're wanting to get back to their roots and understand what you've been speaking about. So let's begin. Amish, my first question to you is, you know, unstereotype, this is the campaign that we are running, which is let's not, you know, let's question norms, not necessarily break, but if a norm doesn't fit in to what your goals and lifestyle is, then let's question those, right? Amish, you are an IIM graduate, investment banker turned author. I mean, the risks must be super high. What made you do it? I'm sure you answered this very often, but I love hearing it every time you say it. And also, how much of it was passion and how much of it was pragmatism?
I love the way you said, you know, banker turned author. क्या कर रहे हो? Okay, no, it's like this. I never really thought I was going to become an author. I was always a voracious reader. I loved reading. I still do. I read at least five, six books a month. But I never thought I was going to be an author. And when I started writing, frankly, I was just writing for myself. I didn't really think where it would go, to be honest. In terms of the decision, look, I come from a middle class family, so you know, very conservative, pragmatic, even boring in my decision, at least in my career decisions. So I resigned only after my second book, when my royalty check became more than my salary. So the decision to become a full-time author was a very practical, pragmatic decision. And it's one of the things I advise all people who want to follow their dreams, that essentially what is following your dreams? You want to follow your heart, right? Your heart wants to do something. So you shouldn't suppress your dream. You shouldn't suppress your heart, because then life isn't worth living. But don't just jump without thinking. Don't listen only to your heart. Listen to your mind as well, right? So let your heart, in fact, I've used this line in one of my books, let your heart decide the destination, let your mind plot the journey, right? So that's what I did. I wrote my first two books along with my job. It was a very difficult 5 6 years. I was working 7 days a week, 13 14 hours a day. You know, a banking job is it's long hours. So I was working at my job also, writing my books also, promoting my books as well, and I resigned only after my second book. So it was a practical, pragmatic decision. I listened to my heart as well. I listened to my mind as well.
That's just so much insight there, because a lot of the women, particularly with COVID, Amish, I think a lot of women really, you know, nurtured entrepreneurship dreams. I think a lot of us really worked on certain dreams, but it's so important to understand that you need to be very pragmatic about really jumping the fence and saying, I'm going to do this full time. Amish, I tried to be a filmmaker. I'm still not making money, so I've not jumped the fence yet. Okay. Then another question I'm sure you're tired of answering. Why not just a sci-fi, you know, thriller or a romance, college romance? Why mythology? It's a lot of hard work.
College romance and all. Okay, you know, the bizarre thing is that when I sent my first book around, Immortals of Meluha, it was rejected by every publisher it was sent to. So I self-published, because remember, I'm talking about 2008, 2009. My first book was published in 2010. And because in those days the only books that were doing well were campus romance novels. And in fact, one of the publishers who rejected my books told me that one of the reasons he's rejecting my book is, he said, look, your storytelling skills are good, it's a good story, but you picked a subject that no one is interested in. No one's interested in religion, people are interested in campus romances, you know, write that. So it's ironic that you should say that. The thing is, look, you write where you draw inspiration, right, from. So I have a story idea in mind which is based in the sci-fi space, by the way. Perhaps the next series will be on that. It's set in the modern day with gaming and time travel, so I might take that up. And I had knowledge in this area because of my family background. You know, our spirituality, our Puranas, our traditions. Hence, the stories emerged out there. Campus romances, look, I mean, I had just one girlfriend, you know, from Age 15, I was married to her, so didn't really have experience of too much campus romances. She is, I mean, we're not married anymore, but like for 25 years, I was basically just a one-woman man. So I'm not so sure I had all the experience to write a campus romance novel.
Great, great, amazing, Amish. So when we read your books, and I think what hits home very strongly is that telling a story is way better than preaching, right? And mythology is, I think mythology, or the way we learned it from our elders, was essentially a way of making us learn skills, aptitudes, the difference between vices and virtues. And I think it had lessons for every generation in terms of crisis, dilemma, how do you deal with it, etc. Also things like Goddess Lakshmi. I come to Lakshmi because Lakshmi is the favorite word for me. But Goddess Lakshmi and Saraswati together have always symbolized the close connect between academics, finance, etc. I'm asking for a very, what should I say, like a unbiased view, not a male or a female view of this, but really, do you think men conveniently and women unfortunately skip these facets of education about financial literacy, independence, everything that, so we've been taught things in a certain way, and we obviously take it the way that we've kind of turned them around and looked at them and said, okay, so therefore this is the role of a man, this is the role of a woman.
No, good question. Look, unfortunately, many of the paradigms we have in today's day is more recently a European paradigm. Before that, a Middle Eastern paradigm. The invaders who came to India, their paradigms were superimposed on us. Our traditional culture did not. It's not that we didn't have roles, right? But it's not that women were expected to just stick at home and not do anything, and men were expected to do finance, medicine, everything. For example, more often than not, medicine was actually taught to women in ancient India. We had women businessmen, women rulers who ruled in their own names. Women, the equivalent of women prophets and messiahs. There are not too many cultures which had the equivalent of women prophets and messiahs, right? So the Rig Veda has hymns written by men and women.
Yeah.
Sadly, many of those traditions got forgotten, right? And then often when you tell people, that look, women's role was different. They were seen as equal in ancient times. They say, no, because we've been so conditioned to believe that our ancestors believe this, that sometimes you have to tell them the obvious things. Like I had a discussion with one person once who said that no, sati was a part of ancient Indian traditions, and I said no, it was not, and it was never a mass tradition. So he said no, it was, because there's this British book, British Raj era book, which said that. So I said, okay, our foundational books were the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. Make a list of the widows out there. Who all of them committed sati? Did Kekai Ma commit sati? Did Kaushalya Ma commit sati? Did Sumitra commit sati? Look at the Mahabharata. How many of them committed sati? Then it was obvious to him, oh yeah, they didn't. So he said, like, I said, the truth is staring you in the face, but you are so, you have imbibed the what the invaders told us about us so deeply that you don't even see it, right? And it's the same thing when it comes to finance, to education. This belief that Indian women weren't supposed to be educated, not true at all, right? This belief that Indian women couldn't run business, again, not true at all. This belief that Indian women couldn't be warriors. The Cholas had regiments which were made of women warriors. The bodyguards of Chandragupta Maurya were all women. Education, among the greatest debates in Indian history ever, was the debate between Adi Shankaracharya ji and Mandana one, I'm sure you've heard of it. It was in the 7th century. The judge of that debate, the judge, and remember, the judge has to be superior to the two competitors. The judge was a woman, Ubhay Bharti. I'm talking about
More.
1400 years ago. We don't know all this. We are not taught it, so we actually. Since that's not our culture. Said it repeatedly that those who fight for equality between men and women are not being less Indian. We are in fact being more Indian. We are being true to our actual culture.
Absolutely. Well said, and I wish we could, you know, the good part about doing an Instagram live is that it's, you know, this piece is going to be live on our feed all the time. So we can keep telling and telling people, go listen to this, right? It's
Go
important
listen to
to
this. Go listen to this. Yeah. No, which is why one has to be very careful also. Take what I say.
True, true, absolutely. Totally true. Amish, we are getting a lot of, before I ask my question, I think there's so many questions around when is your next book coming out, and I think you've just released Dharma, and you know I've been reading it with your sister Bhavna ji. Tell us a little bit, and also what's next in pipeline, and tell us a little bit about Dharma. You know, what is the
Don't.
difference with Dharma, how
No,
is
I do have a copy of it. There you go. This is my latest book, Dharma. This is Instagram, so it's a mirror image. But this is Dharma, written by me and my sister, Bhavna Roy. This is it's a non-fiction book, but it's written in the form of a conversation, an exploration into Dharma, which is at the heart of the Indian way of life. Not just the dharmic religions, which is Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism, but even the way Islam and Christianity are practiced in India is fundamentally different from how it is practiced, these religions are practiced in other parts of the world. And Dharma informs the way all of us Indians practice our faiths. And the true religion, the true translation of Dharma is not religion. The true translation is that which balances, that which binds, that which holds society, universe, everything together. And dharmic philosophies is what informs our way of life. Sadly, we don't learn enough about it. Our education system is still disgustingly colonialized, is disgustingly colonial, rather. We haven't decolonized our education system, so we don't learn these fundamental things of how to lead a good life. That's what Dharma essentially teaches you. That's what we are trying to explore through this book. Simple, easy conversations. We are not marrowing Sanskrit on you out here. We keep it very easy and relaxed so that it's kind of like a beginner course, right? An introduction into Dharma. In terms of the fourth book of the Ramchandra series, that is the first question I get asked anywhere. I think a few weeks back I had posted a picture of me cycling at Hyde Park. I'm in London, and the first comment that I got was me being scolded by one of my readers that stop wasting time, go back home and write the book. So I assure all my readers, I am working on the fourth book of the Ramchandra series. It will release by the end of this year. Suhail Dev and Dharma, which were released last year, those two books last year, they were part of the Writer Center. I've written it with others. It hasn't delayed the fourth book of the Ramchandra series. God promise to you, it is going to release before the end of this year. Tentatively titled War of Lanka. And
Fascinating.
it'll be from this book will be from the kidnapping of Sitama till the end of the war, the end of the War of Lanka, which is with the death of Ravan.
Wow, looking forward. I hope all of you know, several questions on that. I hope that answers it, and we can get on to some more specific questions from Amish.
But I will say, I will say this to all those who scold me that why am I not releasing my fourth book. I don't mind it. As an author, it's wonderful to have readers who ask you that why haven't you released your book, rather than them asking why have you released a book because no one wants to read it. So, thank you.
Another one. I don't think that's coming your way at all. Amish, on that point, since we're talking of the Ramchandra series, and you know, this has been very, I think for me, reading the way you depicted Sita was actually an eye-opener, right? So from Valmiki and Doordarshan's demure Sita, I'm suddenly reading about, you know, Amish's Warrior of Mithila. which is a far more emancipated, assertive Sita. And not just Sita, I think even the way you depict Draupadi, right? Very strong characters and literally women who are breaking glass ceilings at that point in time, right? Probably easier at that point in time than it is today to break those glass ceilings. So my question to you really is that, why is mythology really depicted the way it is? Why have we always seen that version of a woman in all of this, and why is it that your version is so different? And because I feel very strongly, because that, the way you depict them can be actually a huge, it could be a very big tool to make women themselves think, right? And like I said, think about what we've thought of norms always, that this is not really a norm. It's something that we've just learned through stories, and therefore it may or may not be the right description of a woman that we've revere literally.
The image we have in mind of Sita Ma, as you said rightly, is based largely on a 1980s television serial. I'm talking about urban India, not rural India. Who may have, seen Ram Leelas, who may have read the text, etc. I'm talking about urban India, modern urban India. And the With all respect to Ramanand Sagar ji, the maker of the 1980s television serial, I think he did a fantastic job. But it was not completely based on the Valmiki Ramayana, it was based more on the Ramcharitmanas. And in fact, Ramanand Sagar ji made so many changes to it that perhaps the best way to describe the 1980s television serial is Ramanand Sagar ji's Ramayana, So the image we have of Sita Ma is actually defined more by that 1980s television serial. This
Absolutely.
is not the way she has been described in our ancient versions. And again, it is a misfortune of our education system that we don't read the ancient versions. So you mentioned the Valmiki Ramayana. Let me tell you this from the Valmiki Ramayana. There are many, texts of the Valmiki Ramayana. A critical edition was made. From the various different versions of the Valmiki Ramayana itself, because it was written right in so many different parts of India. But some of them have an incident that when Lord Ram was being banished into the forest, right? And at till that time he had still not informed Sita Ma, Lord Ram, that I'm going. And in which at which time Sita Ma told him, I'm coming with you to the forest. Before that, But after his banishment had been ordered, Guru Vashisht, who is a Saptarishi and who was the Rajguru of Ayodhya, he suggested that since Lord Ram is going to go into the forest, Sita Ma can sit on the throne. Can you imagine that? Guru Vashisht said that in the Valmiki Ramayana,
I don't think
right?
you've heard of that
Now,
name.
so forget about breaking glass ceilings. There were no glass ceilings in those days. This and it wasn't. No one told him, ki, what are you saying? How can a woman say no? And the Rajguru of Ayodhya said that. Okay. Of course, it's a different matter that Sita Ma tells Lord Ram that I'm your wife. I'm coming with you to the to the forest. This is the Valmiki Ramayana. There's a version of the Ramayana called the Adbhut Ramayana, in which there are two Ravans. The main Ravan is the elder Ravan, who was killed by Sita Ma when she took her true form of Ma Kali, not by Lord Ram. He was killed by Sita Ma. Now, these are versions that are part of our ancient traditions. We don't read these, sadly, so we don't know. So once again, we believe what the British Raj told us, and what sadly our establishment elite in the last 70 years, the anglicized elite, told us about our own culture. And most of the, I have said this to the anglicized elite also, whenever I meet, the ones who live in Latin Delhi, etc., that many of you guys don't realize our ancient culture is actually your biggest ally in terms of liberalism. But many of them have not read our ancient text, so they don't know, right? I'm talking about Indian anglicized elite. We just need to read our texts, and I'll say it again, those who fight for equality between men and women, are not being un-Indian, they are in fact being more Indian. So therefore, even my book, I know, even my book, Sita Warrior of Mithila, it appears like I've done something new. I have not. I've only gone back to what our ancient culture actually was. I'd love to take credit that, oh, I've created something new, and and I'm this, great feminist. No, I have just gone back to what our ancient culture was.
Wow, amazing. So all you women out there, come on, get on and take your boardroom seats, because that is what Abhishek is saying, that it's not, if
That
seat for the throne, you're
was a part of our ancient culture. We had women war. We had women rulers who ruled in their own name. Rudrama Devi, for example, who used to lead her armies into battle. Or Prabhavati Gupta, the great Vakataka queen. They used to rule in their own name. This is our tradition.
Wow, you do know my last name is Gupta, right? So
There you
interesting.
go. You're a ruler. You're a ruler.
Absolutely. At least my team believes so. So, and I'm not going to ask them what kind of ruler, but yeah, this topic. So, Amish, I mean, of course, a lot of our viewers are sending us, questions on when is your series being made? Is it being made on the OTT platform? But really, before you came on, all our questions were on investing and finance. And now, see, we've just like jumped on to OTT platform. When is this being, adapted for the big screen, etc. So one word on that, and then we'll switch back to the finance.
Yeah, so I mean, I'm in fact my last fiction book, which is Legend of Suhail Dev, I've turned producer myself. So I've set up my own company in Mumbai. My elder brother Anish Dada has joined. There's a TV executive who'd worked for 14 years, Aman Gurbada, who's joined, and we are producing it ourselves. We've got some partners on Wakao Films, Casa Media, and we're working on that. And hopefully a good movie will emerge. So in a sense, even in the movie project, I am doing a bit of what we'd done for my book, that it wasn't working out, so we self-published it and launched it. Abhi movie bhi hum log khud hi karenge.
I
Shivji ka aashirwad rahega aur karenge.
absolutely sure. And I think the visual medium is even far more effective, right? It's so impactful. It's just also, I think most of the youngsters, even elder people, we've all become very passive. So, dikha do to aur acha hai, instead of padhao. So that's great news. Amish, we can move back to you and I were having this conversation when we were discussing this, that we were talking about why financial acumen and strength is a necessity, particularly for women, men and women, but more so for women. And I remember you, I think, you explained very, very beautifully how there is like a dominant paradigm in every age. And I'd love for you to take us through, our viewers to take us through, because it's important for people, and especially women, because I talk to women, to understand that why is it so critical, right? To make sure that you are financially independent, and financial freedom is, or financial strength is, important in these days and times.
There's this theory that I have. In fact, actually, it's drawn more from our ancient ways. We had various theories on time and on ages, ancient India. And among those theories is that there's a dominant paradigm for each age. There's a yug dharma, right? And you should be aware of the yug dharma and be in alignment with it if you actually want to succeed, or at least make sure your swa dharma, your personal dharma, is not in too much of conflict with the yug dharma. So in this theory, and I'd written an article on this in my first non-fiction book, Immortal India, that every age has its own paradigm for causing change, right? So, for example, today's day is the age of money. And if you have the greater the money you have, the greater your power to cause change in the on the world. A few centuries ago, this wasn't the case. The dominant paradigm was violence. You know, so the Turks who invaded us, we call the Delhi Sultans or the Mughals, they were Turks essentially. Those same Turks invaded many other parts of the world as well. The Turks were good at only one thing: violence. They weren't really good at trading, knowledge, universities, and all to Kustani. Okay, but they were the best in the world at violence. They were, I mean, beyond comp probably the greatest warrior race humanity has ever seen, the Turks, right? That gave them a comparative advantage where they were the superpower of the world from the 12th century till around 16th, 17th century. Not just in India, across the world, right? Even in today's day, you'll find societies who are damn good at violence. But are they the superpowers in the world? Not necessarily. The superpowers of the world are those with the most money. In those days, India and China had the most money, right? In
Right.
the age of violence. But we were conquered by the Turks here, Mongols in China, and the soldiers of the Mongol army in China were the Turks, right? So us having money did not help us, right? The Turks being very good at violence helped them because that was the dominant paradigm of that age.
Right.
In today's day, the dominant paradigm is money. Like many, you know, there's an age of knowledge as well. There's, you know, so there's an age of violence, age of money. So it keeps changing. What is the dominant paradigm? But today's dominant paradigm is the age of money. Okay, so if you want to be independent, if you want to have power, you want to have the ability to defend your own interests and impact others, money makes a big difference. And that is the paradigm of the day. So be in alignment with this. That's the theory, essentially. So which is why the ability to earn money, the ability to manage money is even more critical at this point in time.
All
That's
right.
a theory. It's much more complex. It is in detail in my Immortal India book. But on Instagram, I'm just giving a brief summary of it.
That's all right, but I think all you folks listening, pay heed, please manage your money because this age, this is essentially the dominant paradigm. So, great that I love the way you explained it and absolutely. And I think we're going to use it when we talk about money management, actually. Amish, one thing about our ancient culture, right? A lot of what we do is drawn from them. For example, we used to talk about like Stridhan is, it's been something that has been spoken about. Even today, income tax will keep aside, the money that you have as a woman. If it's Stridhan, they cannot touch it. Obviously, we've taken some traditions that are good and some traditions which have obviously now become bottlenecks or, pretty much like obstacles for a lot of us. But I'm very, I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about Sridhan and what does it mean and how did that originate?
Look, a good way to learn about this is to read the Smritis. In our scriptures, they are divided into two groups. The first are the Shrutis, that's which is heard. So the Vedas and some believe the Upanishads as well are the Shrutis. These are divinely inspired. These have come from the divine. And then there are the Smritis. Smritis is that which is remembered, but they are essentially law books, right? The most you know, the most famous Smriti in today's day is the Manusmriti. But that wasn't the only Smriti in ancient times. You know, there's the Vyasa Smriti, Apastamba Smriti, the Parashara Smriti, many Smritis, right? Some of the Smritis were very conservative, such as the Manusmriti. Some of the Smritis were very liberal, so liberal that they would shock even modern Americans, right? And these were very clearly the work of men and women, of human beings. They weren't divinely inspired, so which meant that every, you know, when as times change, you create your own smriti, right? So it's not that these things can't be changed or anything like that. It's not like it's the word of God, this law, so you can't change it as any. So like the smriti of the modern day is essentially the Indian Constitution, correct? That's the concept. Now if you read many of these smritis, it gives you an idea of women's inheritance rights. Like one doesn't find mention of, at least I haven't read about dowry, okay, in any of these, but one does find Stridham. What is Stridhan? Stridhan is essentially the daughter's inheritance rights from her parents, okay, which she carries with herself when she goes to her husband's house, and it remains with her. It is her property, right? Which is why you'll find Stridhan was always in the form of movable property, right? So it would either be gold or it would be animals, because cows and were very, very valuable, right, in ancient times. So Stridhan was usually in the form of movable property, which is why you'll find India has such ancient, such a huge hoard of gold. India is not, we didn't have the biggest gold mines in the world, right? The biggest gold mines were in other parts of the world. We did have a few, but we didn't have the biggest gold mines. But the largest hoard of private gold in India, in the world, is in India. This is despite the Turks and the Europeans having looted so much of our gold away, right? Because a lot of this was essentially centuries of trade surplus and then given to women as Sridhan, right? It would either be in temples or it would usually be Sridhan. So Sridhan was essentially the daughter's inheritance rights from the parents, usually in the form of movable property, so that she can carry it with her when she goes to her husband's house. And at least I haven't come across dowry in the ancient Smritis.
That's interesting, and I think what's also very interesting is that even today, the Stridhan is essentially gold, right? It's gold and cash that a woman has, and that needs to change.
Usually, because in a flat in Mumbai you can't keep a cow or goat. So yeah.
Not that, but today, because you could give, you have other instruments, for example, you have mutual funds, stocks, etc., but those essentially is not. Stridhan still continues to be gold and, cash. And I think that is where a lot of the things, I think, our policies also need to change along with
I know, I think if there's one thing which defines Indian culture, it is the ability to keep the best of the old and add in the best of the new. We are not hidebound. We are not ki boss, 2,000 साल पहले, 3,000 साल पहले ये आ गया था, तो now this law can never be changed. ऐसा नहीं है. This is not the Indian way. So, Stridhan is the daughter's inheritance rights, but it doesn't have to be gold. It can be shares. It can be mutual funds. Like I said, we can create our own Smriti in today's day. Why not?
Totally. I think we need you to come as advisor, one education advisor, and the second a little bit on the financial advisor for at least for us women. I think we really like what you're saying. So, Amish, any thoughts in terms of really because you also have you've been an investment banker. You have been on that side of the fence as well. You've done this journey as an author. Anything that you'd like to tell, viewers listening in about really, money management, any lessons, any two, three, four lessons that you feel are very important? I think money management is essentially very simple. It's not an art like when I was a financial advisor, even I used to use jargons and make it sound like an art. But I think it's very simple, and I think what, would love to hear from you over the years.
Bankers do that, man. I mean, we use jargon to confuse the daylights out of others. That is a sad truth. But the reality is, look, money management is there's no rocket science to it. It's pretty simple. So I used to have those golden rules ki bhai jitni chadar hai utni pav phailao, right? So your expenses must always be in control and should be below your income. I wouldn't take loans for anything outside of a good long-term asset. So I wasn't. I would never take loans for holidays. I won't take loans for that. I'll earn myself, and I'll, excuse me. If at a certain stage my income was only such that I could take holidays just around the city, then I would do that. Once I earned enough, then I would go abroad. So don't take loan. So one, keep expenses under control. Second, loans only for good appreciating assets, like for a house or you're starting a business, then it's worth it, right? But taking loans for indulgences is not a good idea, in my opinion. Again, that's the second rule that I take. Third, the money that you save, invest it. The most powerful force on earth is compound interest, right? So you start early, save and invest, have a good portfolio allocation, make sure there's enough risk weightage. If you put everything in debt, you're not going to earn enough to tide over inflation. Fourthly, my view is, as an investor, I would look far more at macro factors than micro. I think that defines your returns over the long term a lot more. If you invested in the US in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and you just benefited from a long boom. But if now is US really a great investment? Are the macro numbers that you see in US positive? I don't know. I'm not so sure, right? At a macro level, I'm an India bull, right? We're a $3 trillion economy, the fifth largest in the world right now. We've only just begun. Infrastructure investments are booming. We will have, ups and downs through the next year or two. I mean, the COVID pandemic has been a disaster, of course. But if you see over the long run, over the next 10, 15 years, this is perhaps the last great massive opportunity. It's like investing in China in the 1990s. So the macro factors on India are fantastic, in my opinion. The Ganga plains, UP, Bihar, West Bengal will join the economy strongly now because massive infrastructure investments are taking place out there. I mean, I've got practically all my equity money is all in India. Over the next 10, 15 years, I see it doing exceptionally well. It'll be among the best asset classes anywhere in the world.
I think we now know the reason for the equity markets here rising, because all of Amish's money is coming in here. But I think very, very well said, Amish, and all of that. And we get a lot of questions in our community. We get a lot of questions from women on how to come out of debt traps. And I think it is so disheartening to hear that young women have got into debt traps. So all the advice that you've given there is great.
No, this is critical. Many youngsters are getting into this that I want to enjoy life right now. Don't take loans for indulgences. This is a golden rule. And you want to indulge yourself, work hard and earn more, right? And if you have, don't take loans for indulgences. It's not a good idea.
Absolutely. So we talk about the bad debt and the good debt theory, where if you have to take a loan, it has to add value. Either you're upskilling or you're creating an asset. Only then you should take a loan. And of course, look at that stuff. So great, great tips, Amish. Really nice. And I think the one thing that I loved what you said was, use your heart to pick the destination and use your head to plot the journey. I think that is just so important in everything we do. I think all of us have passions, dreams, etc. But to follow them, just make sure that you are putting a realistic journey to it. So great, Amish. Thank you so much. Really loved this session with you. We can talk endlessly. I have just one last question. Are you going to write on any other woman mythological character?
Yeah. There are various ideas. I mean, I have written one book on Sita Warrior of Mithila. But yeah, there are many other ideas. I will write.
So I think from Lakshmi, we really urge you to write more of those because those are, they are very, very impactful. I think women who read them really question a lot of the norms that they've been following or mindsets, and in a good way, in a very, very healthy, good way. So we really look forward to more books from you, more women-oriented books as well. I know you have lots of fans asking for the fourth book and the Mahabharata and all of that. Yes, absolutely. All of those too. Thank you so much, Amish, and taking time out. It's been a pleasure. And, I think we can talk endlessly about the subject that we are on, but unfortunately, time is a constraint. So thank you so much, Amish, and forward to seeing you. And please enjoy Hyde Park because I think that's a luxury.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. But just to repeat, I am writing. Don't scold me.
Yes, keep writing as well. Thank you. Thanks, Amish.
Bye. Okay. Bye.
Bye. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. This was really a great session. We still have questions coming in. So thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for logging in. And this session will be saved on our handle as IGTV. So you can always listen in. Thank you.